Welcome to my presentation about components. You all know components one way or another. You know, if you loaded anything from the warehouse into SketchUp, you know components. But I want to show you a few things about components that the casual user might not know and that you might not have used before. Show you some new things. At the end, I want to show you how this whole thing of IFC classification actually comes into this whole project now. And so that'll be really interesting, actually pulling it into the newest version of SketchUp, of course. Okay, so I do like organized models. Let's start from that perspective. I'm German, I'm an engineer, and I'm a Virgo. So of course I like anything that's organized. In any case, components are a great way to organize your projects. They don't just come as objects in, even if you model something from scratch, you know, even if you do landscaping and walls and all kinds of stuff that's not too repetitive, it can help you there too. You know, you can use components for scheduling and for all kinds of estimating purpose and all kinds of other stuff that I want to show you. Just a real quick one off the bat. I wanted to find out who has SketchUp Pro and who has free. So who's a pro user? Okay, and who's using SketchUp free or make? Okay, alrighty. So I'm gonna show a lot of stuff that's relevant to all of you, of course. Interesting to see that there's such a big pro user base in here. Some of the things are not available in the free version, but then again, you know, you can pull things in, of course. Okay, I decided against PowerPoint, so that's why we're in SketchUp here, of course. So I'm gonna do a lot of live modeling of sorts to kind of show you what I'm going over here. All right, so we're good here. All right, so let's assume you want to do something in SketchUp. Let's assume you want to make a visualization of how much oil we use on a daily basis, whatever, something like this. And in order to do that, of course, you need to draw an oil can. An oil can, as we know, is round. I don't know the exact measurements, so don't get me, you know, don't quote me on that, but I went with a 2-foot diameter, and I'm gonna extrude it by 3 feet. Am I close? Anybody got some experience? As you all know, anything that's round, if I look at my hidden geometry right here under view hidden geometry, has a lot of edges. Now I went with a default circle. If I had been even more curious about precision, then I might have increased that number of edges there, of course. So we get a lot of geometry right here. Alrighty, so now I wanna make some copies. So I'm gonna go ahead and make a copy here 5 feet away. Let's make a bunch of them because after all, we wanna make a big case here of us using a lot of oil, I guess. Okay, so at this point we got 100 copies of that, but since we're using so much oil, we need more. So I'm gonna go up. Okay. And SketchUp's thinking, of course, and now we're getting into the realm of what's your graphics card going to be able to do? Because there's a lot of faces in there that need to be shown and moved around and highlighted and so on and so forth. Now, you're lucky, of course, because with the latest version of SketchUp, they made it more responsive. But it's still a lot. And you see here already, you know, you've got the geometry is, you know, the edges are degrading. It's not that nice, sketchy edge once you move around and so on and so forth. Okay, so let me save this file. I'm gonna save it right here. And just for the fun of it, I'm gonna check how big that file is. Now, it's this one here, components oil can. So 7.5 megabytes of geometry. So once you have objects that are repetitive and that are round one way or another, or have lots of edges any other way, components can really help you. So now let me get rid of most of these guys here. And you see already, again, it's a whole performance thing. Has anyone run into these performance things where you model a lot and then gums up kind of? Yeah. And I found, you know, especially for the casual user, that is very, very frustrating because then they get turned off. But if they had done it right the first time around, then it would have been so much easier. Okay, so I'm going to take my oil drum here. It's, as you noticed, I didn't group it even. And now I'm going to turn it into a component. So I'm going to right-click and say make component. There's some stuff that I could do here, but I'm not. And I'm going to do the same as I did before. Oops. I messed that one up. So this is now the speed modeling contest. And now these are, of course, copies of components. And I'm going to do my last round here, 5 feet. There you go. That was much faster already, wasn't it? So I mean, you saw already, and my display is much better. You saw already, you know, just by paying attention to figuring out which are the repetitive components, which are the ones that lend themselves to being turned into components, I make my model much more nimble. And so now I'm going to save this thing. I'm going to go back here. I'm going to check the size again. Look at this here, 386 kilobytes. So now, that was my little model here. You must probably have your own experiences with big models. And that can very easily get out of hand, especially if you pull in components from different sources, you know, that have different quality levels and so on and so forth. And as you see here, the differences between the backup, which is 7.5, and our 380. So there's a big plus in using components just to make modeling much more nimble. Of course, I could have grouped it as well. And I'll maybe a bit later talk about, you know, the difference between the two. And I'm sure you most probably know a good amount of that already. But what if I want to now take my visualization of how much oil we use into how much trees we could plant. You know, basically want to replace these guys with trees. So now when we have components, we can go ahead and load a tree. And I already did that, some kind of an aspen tree, nothing too fancy. And it's not going to fit because it's different size. But what you can do is you can go into your components window, click on the home button so that you see what's in your model. In my model here, I'm going to have one oil can, of course. I didn't name it. And the tree. So now I can actually right-click on this definition here and I say select instances, which means every single copy of this is called an instance and it gets selected. And then I can actually click on the other guy. I can say replace selected. Ta-da! And I just greened the world, if you want to call it that way. It looks awful. Didn't, you know, space them enough. But you get the point. You can basically use components not just, you know, in their final form. You can also very much use components as proxy objects. So I don't know how many of you work with landscape objects, trees with lots of polygons and so on. A lot of rendering software is now switching to using proxy objects where you just put a box in there and then the rendering software pops in a tree. And you can do that in your model too if you basically, you know, create next to the actual model of that tree or whatever some kind of a proxy object, and then you can always go back and forth. You can again, you know, select my proxy objects and replace them. And so that's a really great strategy for modeling. Of course, you can adapt to your client's wishes there too. Another thing where if they change their mind, you can adjust things. Okay. So that's that. And one thing that I want to talk about here, though, is let me show you this. just move this guy over. When you use proxy objects, then you want to, of course, replace the original object where it was placed. And so now, look at this here. If I have my oil can here, what's the best way? Actually, you know what? I'm going to just draw just a line here so that I get the endpoint right here so that I can remember it. So now I'm going to replace this guy with the tree. And you see that the tree didn't get replaced right at the same point. You know, it's a little off to the side, and that's because the base points were different. So if I go back here to my oil can, and I double-click it, you all know most probably you can always double-click a group or a component to get into editing mode. And when I do that, I can see that my axis is off to the side. So if I wanted to use something like this as a proxy object, then I've got to be really careful in placing this the axis properly, or the component, you know, whichever one you want to move inside here. So I can actually move that here as well, so that I could have moved the axis too. You can right-click and place. So that now, I got rid of this guy here, now my origin, the local origin of that of this component is where it's supposed to be. I'll highlight this, I replace it with my tree, and it replaces right where it's supposed to be. So just keep this in mind. Whenever you work with proxy objects, you want to be able to make sure first that everything's correct. Okay. All right. So now let me show you something else. Back to the whole notion of having a model that's efficient. And that could be any kind of model. In my case here, I'm just going to show some woodworking kind of approach. But it could be an architectural model or anything else, basically, where we're now thinking about what could we turn into a component. Originally, we had the oil can because it made sense because we had lots of copies. So in this case here, we could go ahead and basically have this crossbeam, which I'm using up here and again here, and turn that into a component. That would make sense, of course, because you know there's repetition. But you could even go a step further and just do half of that as a component. It has a benefit, especially if you keep changing designs through the process where you need to update things. So in my case here, if I wanted to actually update this end cut one way or another, you know, if I wanted to go right in here, and I'm right in this half beam component of sorts, where, well, let's do a circle right here. Oops, that did not work. Okay, so where if I do this now and change the end piece on one of these, the other side changes too. Now, if I had done the whole beam as one component, which is perfectly fine, then I would have to duplicate that. So again, you know, this is a small model. Think of this on the building scale. You've got a lot of windows in your building. You want to update them one way or another. That's one way to think about it, that, for example, each window pane or each part of a window or something is a nested component in a larger window assembly, basically. So that's a really good way to organize your model again. And now there's a little trick that I used here where obviously when you model something like this, you get an edge right here. That's my question to you. How can I hide an edge? Who knows it? Speed test. Shift erase. So if you do a shift erase, you start the erase tool, hold shift, you can hide an edge. And no, that doesn't make sense up here, but it made perfect sense there, basically between those two adjoining pieces. All right, pass test number one. Alrighty, so that's another benefit of this. Now, there's an exercise that I have been doing with my students for a while, which I always like to do because it really teaches, you know, being very meticulous and good 3D modeler, basically, because you have to think through assemblies. There are a bunch of ways that we can build our models, and you most probably have done that too at some point, where you put something together and then you just kind of push pull until it looks the way it is supposed to look. But then again, you can't take it apart because it's not an assembly. Take a wall with an end cap, where you might want to replace the end cap with something, but you can't because you would have to go into raw geometry. And so the approach that I like to, you know, put out here is basically, I might call it the exploded view modeling, where when you model something like this here, I mean, it's very obvious here, of course, but it could be anything. When you model something like this, you think of it as, could I take the model apart and show it in as an exploded view? You've all seen those views, you know, everything kind of moves out. And in this case here, every single piece, well, in this case it's a nested stud arrangement, every single piece is its own component, or actually group in this case. Model is small enough that you could get away with groups here. So the exercise doesn't only include this part, it also includes an assembly animation. So I tell the students, ask them to actually disassemble it, create a bunch of tabs where in every single next tab, they take a piece away, and next, and next, and next, until we're at the very beginning, and then you can play your animation. You can export it as a video, and it's a real nice, you know, visualization of how things go together. Just a little slow right now, but what that teaches them is really meticulous modeling in terms of really keeping things apart and being able to have an organized model, basically, that you could then later go back and, you know, replace pieces or update pieces. And what I'm going to show you next, schedule pieces, basically. What's that? How?
Yeah.
Yeah. What I did here was basically, assuming there's nothing there, I'd start with animation add scene to get the first tab. And I would start right here at this, you know, at the assembled model. And then I would go ahead and hide a piece like this here. And then simply add another tab. And then, because hidden objects get saved in a tab, you can go for this. This is a really great technique to do a bunch of things. You can hide things, you can turn layers on and off. So especially if you have multiple objects, like you know, if you had all of your joists on a joist layer, you can turn that off and be done with it. Otherwise, you have to select them all. Whenever you want to do like a solar animation, it's really great for that too. So it's a really neat technique for that. All right. Yeah, by the way, I forgot to say earlier, you know, if anyone has a question, throw it in anytime. Okay, so actually, we can just go right back there. Right to this one here. Now, once we have a model that's well organized, we can do a lot of stuff with it. And one is to use it for scheduling in the widest sense. You know, you heard most probably earlier, I think John was talking about building information modeling, and where you have data that you add to your model. And that has been possible for a while, of course, especially in dynamic components. So I want to just mention that a little bit. There are different ways that you can do this, of course. Good example was a call that I just got a few days ago where some company, don't remember the name actually, wanted to have a way to estimate scaffolding in SketchUp. And they were thinking about writing a custom plugin and asking somebody to do it, of course, but if you use SketchUp to do estimating, it's really easy to do with components and just simply adding the data that you need to it. So it would be a cost data or some kind of size data or something like this. So let me quickly show you how that works. Now, in my model, I got this all selectable. And there are different ways to getting there. Now, the attribute part is not part of the free SketchUp, so this would be something that you could only do in the pro version of SketchUp. Technically, you can write a Ruby script to do this in the free version because you can add attributes to anything. Don't know how much of a programmer you are, but it's very much possible. Okay, so if I go to component attributes, it's right under window here. I have my component, and by selecting, of course, I see there are my components right here. And now we can add attributes to that. And those could be anything that you can dream of. The most obvious one might be cost. So 2x10 lumber, all right. Let's put the attribute cost in there. And there are different ways to having the user interact with this, and I'll show you both ways. First one would be if you only want to do this for yourself, you can actually just put values right in here. So, I don't know, 2x10. Any numbers? $12. What, $12? Okay. That'll do. All righty. So now we got a 2x10 that costs $12. I can click on the other guys, and you see, of course, the cost values in here. Now, cost didn't automatically get added to the other components. I would have to manually do this. But for now, I'm just going to keep it for this here. Okay, in the pro version, you also have the option to generate a report, which means that you basically schedule or create an Excel file or a text file, basically, where you can list all of those. Now, by default, this is not very flexible. It kind of just spits everything out. There are a bunch of plugins that make that life a little easier. Where you can really customize this and actually customize the component attribute part too. But I can go to generate report. And let's do all model attributes just so that we have it. I'm gonna, might as well just save it there. I would like to open it. And then we got it right here. And what you see here now, because I did name all of the components properly, I got a good list of what they are. I did put them, at least the wall, into a wall subcomponent. You can do that. You can always have nested components, of course. And so then you get the whole tree of what it sits in, basically, that might be of use. And then you see here at the end, there's my cost estimate. So I got my 12 right here, and it already summed it up to $84 for the 2x10s. So got a little bit of cost estimate. Now, of course, there's a lot of other stuff that comes through here that might not be useful. And I said earlier, of course, there are plugins that make this a little more customizable. But it's a great example for where you can use these components for pretty simple data, really. And especially if your company does estimating and so on, this is an easy way to doing that without having to write a plugin, basically. Has anyone used the generate reports? Yeah. So I just showed it to you as an HTML file. It also spits it out as a comma-separated file where you basically then load it into Excel and delete what you don't need, basically. Okay, now that's adding some kind of an attribute basically, that in this case was only usable for me as the person who works with this. Now, if you wanted to provide this capability to the person who doesn't have the pro version and doesn't want to look at, you know, how you set everything up, there's this other window right here, which is component options, right here. And component options basically list those component parts that you want to expose to the user. So in my case, there's nothing there because I haven't set anything yet. But I can go back to cost and look at my right arrow here, and then change this from, well, first of all, it's supposed to be a decimal number, and have the user actually edit this. Can change the name, and decimal numbers apply. And so now I can actually get rid of my definition window here on the left and just use my user-facing component window, where then the user can go in and change that to $20 or something. So that's another way to work with components here. Now, this is not dynamic components yet. So I wanted to show you a way how you can actually use dynamic components. And I know there's far more on that to come later in other presentations. So I really just want to show you a very simple way how you can use components that are actually parametric in a way, that you can interact with them. And at the same time, you can also extract data from it. It's the same two dialogue, those guys. Yeah. So let's do this. Right in a new file here. Okay. So here's what I want to do. I want to plan a new building, and in order to do that, I want to get started with some kind of space layout kind of thing. And as you all know, different spaces have certain square footages attached. So an office, 150 square feet or something. And I wanted to basically define a space dynamic component that I can use to lay out my office and then move that over either into a list of spaces that I have, or maybe even use it as an underlay in SketchUp or in Revit or in any other software. Okay, let's get started. I'm actually just going to get started with a plain rectangle. At this point, it doesn't even matter how big it is, because I'm going to put the parameters in afterwards. Now, I need to turn this into a component. So I'm going to double click again, make component. Same as before. I mean, you might want to name it something that's useful. So I'm going to call it space. I didn't talk much about the other options here. You can always glue a component to a surface. So might make sense going with horizontal, but I'm just going to leave it as it is. If you wanted to use this in a way where then later you might want to replace it, use it as a proxy object where you might want to replace it later, then you could move the component axis somewhere else. Just so that we've done it once, I'm just going to do that. I don't know. We can put it here. But it's a very simple process right now. I'm not going to do this always face camera. That's for the trees and so on. And I'm going to later talk about this here, which is the whole IFC thing. Okay, so we're going to create our component. The rectangle is now a component. And I can go back into my two windows. I can open up the attributes. Right there. The computer doesn't seem to be the fastest. And I can open up the options. Okay, options only shows me the space title right now because that's all I put in there, basically. But I can work with some attributes. And you saw this earlier already. When I clicked on the name here, I got a bunch of things. And for the most part, it's position, size, and where it is. What we want to have right now is the length, because we want to have it created in a way that it's always going to be 150 square feet or whatever number I give it. And no matter how much I stretch it, it'll always stay at that size. So I'm going to use length X and Y. And for the most part, you're not used to working with X's, Y's, and Z's in SketchUp because we got our axes. But X is red, Y is green, and Z is blue. So we can safely ignore blue in this case. So I'm going to put length X in there. Length Y is in there. And you already see how SketchUp pulled the dimensions that I had earlier. I could actually go in here and change it if I wanted to. You know, I can say 50 inches, something like this. Doesn't really matter right now. Okay, I also want to add the attribute that I'm really after, which is the area. And I'm going to call it area SF so that I remember that's in square feet, basically. Right here. Let's give it a number, because otherwise I might complain. Okay, so now we got a component set up with all the attributes that we need. But I want to have a little bit of logic in there so that when I change the length in X, length Y adjusts so that my square footage doesn't change. So I can actually go in here, length Y, and highlight it, equals. And then I can click on my parameter down here, area SF, the spelling just has to be the same, divided by length X, but I need to do my little conversions, of course, because as you all know, SketchUp works in inches. If I type in 150, it would think those are square inches, basically. So I'm going to multiply it by 12 and 12. And then we're pretty good, because now I can go ahead, use the scale tool, and see what happens here. Whenever I adjust it, it's never wrong. It's always at 150 square feet. So it's a really very simple way to kind of show you how you can make dynamic components. But we've created a bunch of attributes. We've used formulas, and we set it up properly. Now, to make it a little more polished, I could actually go down here to the scale tool attribute and turn a few of these off. So I might just want to have it scalable in two directions, right there. And other than that, we're pretty much done. Oh, yeah, the one thing that I want to expose to the user is my is the square footage. Because then I can go here, change the area, and then everything changes. I can get rid of this guy. And we've created ourselves a real nice dynamic component where we can now use it. We could actually give it maybe usage or occupancy or whatever, and then you pop in whether it's an office or something else. And we copy it a bunch of times, and we lay out our building. So that's a really, really neat way to doing that. Let me pull. Yeah, 10 minutes? You pull one thing in from here, which is the same, a little more elaborate. So in my book that that's out, Architectural Design with SketchUp, I described that a little more. And there's actually a space component in there that has things like story height 2 and so on. And then why can't I find it? Right here. So then you can assign a color, areas, story number. If I switch that to 1, it pops down and so on. So that's a nice way to working with dynamic components in this case. Like I said, there's more to come on dynamic components. This gives you a bit of an initial flavor. But as I said before, now you can go ahead, generate your report, save it. And we should have scheduled. Where are we? Yeah, unfortunately, Sophie's still in the model. But you see down here the spaces and so on. So it all comes out nicely. OK, so in my last 10 minutes, I want to show you the new stuff, basically, because As you heard earlier, there's this exchange format between a lot of CAD software and especially BIM software. The IFC format, who's heard of IFC before? Okay, who's used it to exchange something? Who's used DXF instead because it just works? it's interesting. You know, as we all know, all those software manufacturers, they got their own formats, and for the most part, they don't like exchanging files back and forth. But the IFC format has come out as one that lets you at least get some form of, you know, data-rich format from one to the other. And so since 2014, that's now in SketchUp, which is great. So now I can actually go in, and I can do this. I can do this a bunch of ways. As you saw earlier, when I define a component, I can actually give it the IFC classification. But I can also highlight my component, go into entity info, and look under type. And then you see here, there are your most used classification. So you see here, there's beam, there's pile, roof, you know, window, and so on and so forth, and wall. And I can give this now a classification. As you heard earlier, you can actually, you know, even though this is a space object, I could call it a wall right now. All done. And work with it. Doesn't really make sense for us in this case. Actually, I might want to click on this button here, which shouldn't be called simplify. But I can go all the way down. I can search for it. And give it the proper IFC space classification. I'm going to get rid of this one because it's a different type, but then I can go ahead, you know, and go ahead, do my work, and lay out this building. And then when I go ahead and export this now, this is now then properly tagged as IFC space. So if I go to export, file export, 3D model, there we go. you now have the option to export as an IFC file, and you can do that and then pull it into Revit or wherever else you want to use it, of course. So that's another way. And of course, the set of data that you add to this gets exported to. And it's my understanding that the schema that comes with SketchUp isn't the only way you can classify things. You can, as far as I know, go into the guts and basically add another text file of schema data that you might want to customize for your own use, basically, and use a different schema and so on and so forth. So that's the newer way to looking at things. One thing that I found, who's working with Revit a lot in terms of, you know, moving between SketchUp and Revit? Okay, we got some. there's an interesting side thing that I came across just recently where if you basically create a wall, you know, any wall geometry, turn this into a, actually it works with groups too, but turn it into component or something, and then call it a wall, and then pull it into SketchUp. It comes in properly as a wall, pull it into Revit, it comes in properly as a wall, but it doesn't come in as a system family wall. So it's basically properly tagged in the software, but it doesn't allow you to assign layers, for those of you that know Revit, basically. But it's at least lets you, you know, bring the intelligent object from one to the other, basically. Okay, so one thing that I didn't talk about earlier, just to mention it, most of you must probably know it, but what's the difference between groups and components? let me quiz you. Exactly. So if we had that trellis that I had earlier, I may have closed it. No, I still have it open. So if I had done these all as groups, then by putting a circle into one, they wouldn't have changed anything anywhere else, basically. So whenever you have the need for combining geometry, but you don't have the need for reusing it in your model, then groups are great. When you want to do any of the things that I showed you, components are.
What about file size?
file size is better with components because component gets saved once and then just gets instantiated. You only have copies of insertion points, basically, and scale and so on. And so groups are not going to be as efficient as components. Yeah. No. It's just, you know, take some geometry, put it together, and copy it. Alrighty, so that gives us 5 minutes for questions. So if you need to reach me, let me give you some of the contact points, of course. There's a website. There's two websites, actually. One goes along with my book. And Twitter always works. So I'm very open to any kind of questions. I'm actually revising my book. So if anybody has my old version and didn't like something in it, now is the time to tell me so I can change it for the next one. But other than that, I'd very much like to hear any questions. So any?
Yeah? I only use the API to interact with SketchUp. Yeah. How many of the dynamic components, particularly the one that built the formula based on some of the names, is that available in the attribute dictionary?
Well, that's a good question. Let me pull one thing up. Where is it? Where did it go? All right, here. Okay. So if I go to let's do a new one. All right. So Sophie is a dynamic component. You know, if we click on her t-shirt size, color changes or something. So if I go in my code editor, I got this little thing here where it should, no, isn't it? Oh yeah, no, that's it. So this is all we're getting from the attribute dictionary, basically. The dynamic attributes, we get the last state of the, you know, of the attribute that can change, which is the shirt in this case. What's that? Yeah, who can? Okay. It's in there? Okay.
Can you recommend any plugins for components?
There are a bunch of them. Just don't have it off my head. there's a variety of things. You know, if you're a woodworker, there's a Cutlass plugin that basically takes all of your components and I believe groups too, and basically gives you a cut list from sheets. Anybody remember the other one? There's one or two more that where you can.
Where would you find the plugins?
We have the extension warehouse. In SketchUcation, yeah, definitely.
What do you say?
SketchUcation? Yeah. Yeah. And sometimes has things that are not on the warehouse, back and forth. Yeah. To groups, not through this, maybe through the API. API works, huh? Yeah. And attaching attributes isn't that hard. In the API, let me just see if I can. It's literally a one-liner. Okay, who remembers faster than me where to find it? And which one is it under? Entity? Okay, entity and then there's these two here, set attribute and get attribute. So set attribute, basically done here. So you see, you have to you can make a catalog of sorts of attributes that are yours. So you have to give your own dictionary of sorts. And then it's just key and value pairs. And you set it, and then you can get it the same way. Write a name. Any other? That's the time? All right. Anyways, thank you in that case. Thanks.